All right, if you take your Bibles and open to the book of Esther, we're going to continue in our study with Esther. And you'd say, Steve, aren't we supposed to be celebrating Palm Sunday? And I agree. But as I was meditating on this and studying Esther chapter 4, the parallels between this part of the story of Esther and the Messiah's work for us are truly unbelievable. So, a wonderful time meditating in Esther chapter 4 this morning, I assure you. At least if you have half as much fun as I have had in learning from it, you'll have a great time this morning. Let's read Esther chapter 4, starting in verse 1. The scripture says, "When Mordecai learned all that had occurred, he tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes, went into the middle of the city and cried loudly and bitterly. He only went as far as the king's gate, since the law prohibited anyone wearing sackcloth from entering the king's gate. There was a great mourning among the Jewish people in every province where the king's command and edict came. They fasted, wept, and lamented, and many lay on sackcloth and ashes. Esther's female servants and her eunuchs came and reported the news to her, and the queen was overcome with fear. She sent clothes to Mordecai to wear, so he could take off his sackcloth, but he did not accept them. Esther summoned Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs assigned to her, and dispatched him to Mordecai to learn what he was doing and why. So Hathach went out to Mordecai in the city square in front of the king's gate. Mordecai told him everything that had happened, as well as the exact amount of money Haman had promised to pay the royal treasury for the slaughter of the Jews. Mordecai also gave him a copy of the written decree issued in Susa ordering their destruction, so that Hathach might show it to Esther, explain it to her, and command her to approach the king, implore his favor, and plead with him personally for her people. Hathach came and repeated Mordecai's response to Esther. Esther spoke to Hathach and commanded him to tell Mordecai, all the royal officials and all the people of the royal provinces know that one law applies to every man or woman who approaches the king in the inner courtyard and who has not been summoned, the death penalty. Only if the king extends the gold scepter will that person live. I have not been summoned to appear before the king for the last 30 days. Esther's response was reported to Mordecai. Mordecai told the messenger to reply to Esther, don't think that you will escape the fate of all the Jews because you are in the king's palace. If you keep silent at this time, liberation and deliverance will come to the Jewish people from another place. But you and your father's house will be destroyed. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go and assemble all the Jews who can be found in Susa and fast for me. Don't eat or drink for 3 days, day or night. I and my female servants will also fast in the same way. After that, I will go to the king, even if it is against the law. If I perish, I perish. So Mordecai went and did everything Esther had ordered him. So, what you see here is there is great sorrow because of what appears to be the unchecked power of evil. So the story, as a reminder, okay, Esther became queen because the king liked the idea of gathering all of the most beautiful young women in the kingdom for himself and sleeping with them one at a time at his leisure until he chose the next queen. God in his providence had Esther chosen as king, gave her the greatest favor with the king, and she became queen. During this time frame, or I'm sorry, after that time frame, a man rose to power, Haman, and Haman was a brilliant politician and was very, very good at the work that he did in the kingdom. And when he presented his desire for the destruction of the Jewish people, the king gave him his signet ring without even knowing who the people were. And so this is what we see now, is that the Jewish people have learned about this decree. They know what's coming, and there is great sorrow. So we see here that Mordecai mourned the imminent disaster, but he mourned it in such a way as to put himself in harm's way. You say, well, what do you mean? Well, you see, the queen, without knowing the edict, right? Without knowing the edict, she was overcome with fear that Mordecai was wearing sackcloth in the king's gate, as far as he was legally allowed to go within the palace area. Okay? He was drawing attention to himself very awkwardly, and Esther was concerned. I don't know how much you know about rulers, but they don't like bad news any more than you or I do. Okay? And so the idea that Mordecai was drawing this attention to himself in a negative way scared his niece. She was concerned for his health and well-being. So when Mordecai was mourning, and I want you to recognize something here. This idea of mourning over loss is something that is it's so normal that even the Messiah had some time of mourning. In Matthew chapter 14, verse 10, we see this. This is a story of John the Baptist being murdered. So the king had sent, he sent orders and had John beheaded in the prison. His head was brought on a platter and given to the girl who carried it to her mother. Then his disciples came, removed the corpse, buried it, and went to and reported to Jesus. When Jesus heard about it, he withdrew from there by boat to a remote place to be alone. Did you catch this? He withdrew to be alone. Here's what happened. When the crowds heard this, they followed him on foot from the towns. As he stepped ashore, he saw a huge crowd, felt compassion on them, and healed their sick. So if you've ever been in an extremely painful time because of loss, Jesus understands. But sometimes you have severe pain because of something that's happened to you. In Luke 22, we see this in verse 41, also with the Messiah. It says, then he withdrew from there about a stone's throw, knelt down, and began to pray. Father, if you are willing, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel from heaven appeared to him, strengthening him. Being in anguish, he prayed more fervently, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he got up from prayer and came to the disciples, he found them sleeping, exhausted from their grief. Why are you sleeping? He asked them. Get up and pray so that you won't enter into temptation. While he was still speaking, suddenly a mob was there, and one of the 12 named Judas was leading them. So I'm just helping us process that here we see Mordecai in a place of pain and hurt and sorrow. And yet the Lord understood Mordecai, as he also understands you and I in our pain and sorrow, right? And so then there begins this conversation between Esther and Mordecai. Now, not directly, by the way, because Esther could not be seen with somebody in such a state. Somebody who was drawing negative attention to themselves. It would not have been appropriate for her to go to him. So they have this conversation through intermediaries or messengers, right? And so in this conversation, Esther lets Mordecai know that she has not been summoned to appear before the king for 30 days. Now, you and I hear that, and we're like, well, a month went by, okay, life happens, you get busy. Let's for a moment pause and rethink through Esther's situation here, okay? Esther was made queen through a highly inappropriate process. She had no wealth or family connections to secure her position as queen or to secure her life if the king did not find favor with her. The king also had not only his harem full of women, he also had plenty more young women from around the kingdom that he had not slept with yet, but when he chose Esther. Okay? So when Esther had not been summoned to the king for 30 days, you have to know with great confidence that she was wondering why she had not been pleasing enough to him for him to want her. He had other women. So for whatever reason, the king had not wanted to be with the queen, and for 30 days there had been no contact. My point is to remind us that she was not in a secure position. She was in a very vulnerable position. So her fear and reminding her uncle Mordecai of the appropriate fear that she had makes a lot of sense. As a matter of fact, she's probably already wondering, when will the king decide that he's had enough of me and just have me killed and replace me? You have to imagine that that thought had somehow crossed her mind in the 30 days of not being wanted. But here is Mordecai's words to her, and I think this is quite powerful as we think through this. He says, "Don't think that you will escape the fate of all the Jews because you are in the king's palace." And here's the point, okay? Nobody in the king's inner circle knew that Esther was a Jew. But there were people in the city of Susa, the palace area of Susa, that had grown up with her, that knew who she was. And don't you think that there would be somebody for sure who would say, you know what, if me and my whole family are going to die, I'm at the very least going to take somebody down important with me. I'm going to let you know who else is a Jew here and see how far you're going to go with this. All right. And so Mordecai's reminder was that not only was she in a tenuous position as queen, she was not safe from the edict because somebody was going to talk as their family was being killed. Somebody who knew her. This idea of not escaping is something that each one of us feels in our own spirit. We see the story of Esther and we go, yeah, she was in a bad spot. But you know something? You and I know that we cannot escape the punishment of sin. We cannot escape the justice that we deserve. But here's what the Lord says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 2, it says, "For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come just like a thief in the night. When you say peace and security, then sudden destruction comes on them, like labor pains come on a pregnant woman. And they will not escape. But you, brothers, are not in the dark for this day to overtake you like a thief. For you are all sons of light and sons of the day. We do not belong to the night or the darkness. Hebrews 12 says this in verse 25, make sure that you do not reject the one who speaks. For if they did not escape when they rejected him who warned them on earth, even less will we if we turn away from him who warns us from heaven. His voice shook the earth at that time, but now he has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also heaven. The expression yet once more indicates the removal of what can be shaken, that is, created things, so that what is not shaken might remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us hold on to it, let us hold on to grace. By it we may serve God acceptably with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. This prophetic message that came through Mordecai is quite powerful when he says, don't think that you will escape the fate of all the other Jews because you are in the king's palace. You know, there is a reality that you and I deal with all the time. You want to know what that reality is? We want justice for everybody except ourselves because we don't want what we deserve. Just life. We want everybody else to be held accountable, but when we make a mistake, we're like, yeah, I don't mind being held accountable, but let's not make it too severe, okay? All right, let's take it easy on me, all right? I know what I deserve, but let's not go there, all right? And yet, he says, don't think that you will escape. And the truth is that we cannot escape God's judgment except through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he says, here's what he also says. Here's another statement, prophetic statement that he gives by faith, which the Lord gives to him. He says, if you keep silent at this time, liberation and deliverance will come to the Jewish people from another place. Do you catch what he says? If you reject to be used by God, God will send somebody else. The question is, did God send somebody else? Yes, he did. Because he sent the Messiah. He used Esther, and he still prophesied through Mordecai that somebody else was going to come and bring deliverance for the Jews. Sorry, it's a trick question, brother. Yeah. Right? As a matter of fact, I want you to know something. Mordecai would have had access to these written scriptures, and I want to read some of these for you so that you can see that he was referencing scripture and not just his own opinion, though the Lord prophesied this through him. Isaiah 52 says this in verse 9. It says, be joyful. Rejoice together, you ruins of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord has displayed his holy arm in the sight of all the nations. All the ends of the earth will see the salvation of our God. Joel said this in chapter 2, verse 30. I will display wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood, fire, and columns of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and awe-inspiring day of the Lord comes. Then everyone who calls in the name of Yahweh will be saved. For there will be an escape for those on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem, as the Lord promised, among the survivors the Lord calls. Zechariah says this in chapter 9, verse 9. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout in triumph, daughter Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, humble, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So here we have the Lord prophesying his truth through Mordecai. And Mordecai's statement is so incredible that he is so confident in the promises of God that he is aware, the ones that he was aware, he's so confident in those promises that he says, even though God could use you if you're willing, if you are not willing, God will still send somebody else. And the amazing thing is, here we have a what is known as a double prophecy, or the two prophecies coming out of the same point of Scripture. Because guess what? God did use Esther. She was willing, but God also sent another deliverer, a greater deliverer. One that not only delivered the lives of his people, but delivered their souls from eternal damnation in hell. By the way, that is the appropriate use of the word, in case you're wondering. And he says this, "Who knows, perhaps you have come to your royal position for such a time as this." I tell you what, here we have prophetic statements of faith when he says, "Don't you think that you will escape the fate of all the Jews?" Right? And he says, "But if you keep silent, God will send somebody else." But then he says this, "Perhaps you have come to your royal position for such a time as this." You know, here you have Esther in a very vulnerable, uncomfortable position. Yes, she had wealth. Yes, she had her needs taken care of. But she was not secure in her position. And here he says, "But what if God puts you here for this reason?" Here's a challenge that you and I deal with all the time. And the challenge is, are you going to do what God has placed in front of you by faith? Or are you going to avoid it because the fear of failure and the fear of people responding painfully to you is a very real fear? It's a very real fear. As a matter of fact, it's so real that Esther reminded Mordecai that her life was on the line. And by the way, we'll spend some more time on this in coming weeks, probably not next week, but in following weeks, we'll spend some more time looking, because as we go on, I want you to recognize that her life was not just on the line to approach the king. Her life was on the line the entire time, because what she wanted him to do he had no reason to do it. None. As a matter of fact, his kingdom stood to get great wealth from him doing nothing. So just going before him and not dying because she walked before him was only step one of her not dying. From her perspective, there was so much that could have happened, that many ways she could have been told, "No, your story is over." And so you and I face these same challenges, because every single one of us, God has placed around us in our lives things that he has called us to do. Sometimes you're so aware of it that it's staring you in the face. You can't look in the mirror. You can't wake up in the morning without being reminded, "Okay, God, this is what you've placed in front of me." Other times it's, "Okay, Lord, I don't know what it is, but give me the faith to keep trusting you while I wait for you to reveal it is what you want me to do." In either case, that faith and that trust in God is difficult. And here we have this reminder, not only for Esther, but also for us. And he says, "Perhaps you have come to your royal position for such a time as this." I want to read from you from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, speaking about God working in our lives. He says this in verse 26 of 1 Corinthians 1. "Brothers, consider your calling. Not many are wise from a human perspective, not many powerful, not many of noble birth. Instead, God has chosen what is foolish in this world, in the world, to shame the wise. And God has chosen what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God has chosen what is insignificant and despised in the world, what is viewed as nothing, to bring to nothing what is viewed as something, so that no one can boast in his presence. But it is from him that you are in Christ Jesus, who became God-given wisdom for us, our righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. in order that, as it is written, the one who boasts must boast in the Lord. Now you say, Steve, that's great, but we see how God worked in her story. But let me remind you that the king had not desired even to be with her for 30 days. He chose to be with other women because they pleased him more. And here she is saying, I need you to change the law and give up a fortune for my life. I think that no matter what difficult step of faith that you are dealing with, that Esther would probably understand the stress and the difficulty. But I think the Lord also prophetically is wanting each one of us to answer the question that maybe he put you in your position today for such a time as this. I don't know what that time is. I don't know what he has put in front of you right now, but I guarantee it's going to take faith. And I guarantee it's scary. You say, well, how do you know that? Well, we just read that, what did he say here? He says in 1 Corinthians, right, that God has chosen what is insignificant and despised in this world, what is viewed as nothing, to bring to nothing what is viewed as something. So that's me, insignificant and despised and viewed as nothing. That means that no matter what he's going to do through me, I'm going to be afraid because he's going to use me to do something against those who are viewed as something. It's a David versus Goliath story. It's impossible. It's just not going to happen. There is no hope except for the power of God. And so here we see Esther reply, and her reply is so incredibly faith-based. It's truly incredible to see the faith that God gave this hurting and vulnerable woman. Is that Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, go and assemble all the Jews who can be found in Susa and fast for me. Don't eat or drink for 3 days, day or night. I and my female servants will also fast in the same way. Here's an interesting fun fact for you, that God prophetically worked through Esther to point to the Messiah that she would decide by God's leading as she's making a faith-based decision that she's going to fast and pray for 3 days. As a matter of fact, there's 3 days and three nights. Right, what happened with Jonah in Jonah 1:17 says the Lord appointed a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the fish 3 days and three nights. Jesus said this in Matthew 19, and he answered them, an adulterous generation demands a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah, for as Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights, the Son of Man will be in the heart of the earth 3 days and three nights. So here this idea that fasting and praying, going before God, imploring the favor of God because she expects that she will die. So my question for you and for myself is this. Do we implore the favor of God with great intentionality? Or do we arrogantly rush ahead, assuming he's got our back? Unfortunately, if you're like me, you rush ahead far too often. As a matter of fact, I want to read a story for you about apostles who rushed ahead, at least one apostle who rushed ahead and was reprimanded harshly for it. In Matthew 16, verse 21, we see this. From then on, Jesus began to point out to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders, chief priests, and scribes, be killed and raised the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Oh no, Lord, this will never happen to you. But he turned and told Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me because you're not thinking about God's concerns, but man's." We need to be careful how we run ahead of God's plans with our own. Because God gave Peter one of the harshest corrections he could give to one of his children. He said, "Get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me." You know what? I don't want to be an offense to God. I don't want to line up with Satan's plans and not God's plans. And what did he say to his disciples after that? This is amazing. His compassion on them and yet his instruction at the same time. He says in verse 24, "If anyone wants to come with me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life because of me will find it. What will it benefit a man if he gains the whole world yet loses his life? Or what will a man give in exchange for his life? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father. Then he will reward each according to what he has done." When we seek for God's favor, we also seek for his plan and what he would have us to do with our lives. Esther put her life in God's hands. And she saw God work powerfully because she trusted him. And yet here we have a great statement of faith when she says, "Even though it's against the law, if I perish, I perish. I will still go forward in faith." Jesus said this in Matthew 6:10, teaching us how to pray. He said, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Do we really mean that when we pray? Then why do we wonder if God loves us when he answers the prayers his way and not our way? Why do we assume that he doesn't hear us or that he's abandoned us when he's silent? Well, I mean, I sort of kind of wanted his will to be done, but especially when it lines up with my will. Then we're in great agreement. This is great. When his will doesn't align with my will, maybe I'll pray harder, then he'll change his will. Maybe I'll fast some more so that God can see how important it is to me and how I'm right. And yet, what did Jesus say in his height of grief in Matthew 26, verse 38? He said this, "Then he said to them, 'My soul is swallowed up in sorrow to the point of death. Remain here and stay awake with me.' Going a little farther, he fell face down and prayed, 'My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will.'" Knowing what was coming, Jesus asked if he wouldn't have to go through it. Don't you think, as you think of Esther, that in those 3 days of fasting and prayer, that at some point in those 3 days, she said, "Lord, it'd be great if you just change this law now. Save me from putting my life on the line, please." I'm sure she did, because she was only human. Every single one of us would say, "God, can you just save me from this really dangerous situation? Can you just kind of remove it before I go through it? That'd be fantastic." And guess what? Jesus understands. He understands, and he said, "If it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Your will be done." So what is it that we can learn from this story? Well, I'm so glad you would ask, because Philippians 2 says this in verse 5. It says, "Make your own attitude that of Christ Jesus, who, existing in the form of God, did not consider equality with God as something to be used for his own advantage. Instead, he emptied himself by assuming the form of a slave, taking on the likeness of men. And when he had come as a man in his external form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on a cross. For this reason, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. As you face the situations where God has put you in alive and in there for such a, in that situation for such a time as this, make your own attitude that of Christ Jesus, who did not take what was rightfully his, but chose to do what was best for you and I. And we see even by faith that Esther was willing to take the same attitude. She said, if I perish, I perish. I'm going to do what needs to be done for the sake of those around me, even if it costs me my life. By faith, she was exemplifying an attitude like Jesus had. The same attitude that God calls you and I to have as we face problems that we go, honestly, this could change everything, even cost me my life sometimes, but it could, I don't know, God, this is so radical, I don't know what to do about it. What do you, I don't even understand. I'm too confused. And make your own attitude that of Christ Jesus. Choosing to do what is best for those around you, regardless of the cost for yourself. It's a statement of faith. The Messiah took that statement of faith as he entered Jerusalem, and we're going to wrap up here, but he entered Jerusalem on the colt, the foal of the donkey, right? The same crowds that would days later say to crucify him, not all the same people, but the crowds, the same people on the streets, they came and they waved palm branches before him. They announced his coming as, here comes Hosanna, the son of David. Here comes the future king. And I love what I love what happened. The priest sends someone to Jesus and they say, don't you hear what they're saying? Tell them to be quiet. And Jesus said, if I were to tell them to be quiet, the very rocks would cry out. And here's what we need to be remembering from this. God doesn't need you. He doesn't need you to do anything to accomplish his will. But he chooses to use you if you're willing to follow him by faith. As a matter of fact, you don't even need to show up at church and praise God. He's going to be praised whether you're here or not. He's going to be praised because the rocks will cry out praise to his name if you don't. But the question is, are you going to trust him for such a time as this? Are you going to let him use you even though the cost is more than you want to give? I think as we see the story of Esther unfold, we'll see that God works as we take steps of faith. And what we see is God working, and I hope that you are willing to take the difficult steps of faith today so that you might see the power of God at work in your weakness tomorrow. But let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the power of your word, the power of it to teach us about yourself and how we can follow you by faith. Thank you for these incredible examples of faith in Mordecai and Esther and the prophetic messages that you gave to both of them. Pointing us towards our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, may each one of us here choose to walk with you by faith, to follow you through the difficulties of life by faith, to put our life on the line for you. Lord, that we might see your power at work through our weakness, that those who consider themselves mighty and strong would look and say, it must have been God at work. For no human being could accomplish what God did. And Lord, for those who are struggling in their faith this morning, Lord, you said that that all that is needed is the faith the size of a grain of a mustard seed. And Lord, I pray that for those who are struggling in their faith this morning, that you would just give them that little tiny bit of faith they need to trust you today with that next step. Just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.